Oh, awesome. And these are our new kids, everyone. Can we give them another round? For our special dads here on earth and in heaven, right? Our special Father in heaven. You ready? All right.
Intro. thank God for this wonderful weather. As Pastor Larry was saying, we came to this church because of the kids of Outreach, Vacation Bible School, which will be coming up soon. And because of that, God came in and transformed our lives, and my wife, my kids. So I'm a father of four kids, two boys, two girls. But on Sundays, I have 40 kids. All of them. You know, it's been a very interesting journey, ups and downs. And preparing for this was interesting. You know, I thought I had the word 3 months ago for this. And last night, I'm up to 2 a.m, and I wake up this morning and it just got changed up. Oh, Jesus is up there trying to give me a video, which might not happen, but we got plan B. This is my first time speaking on a Sunday to adults. So if you don't behave, I'm going to take you back to your parents. And I remember years ago watching Pastor Larry preach, and I asked myself, how does he do this? Then I see Pastor Robert, and I ask myself the same question, how does he do this? And I'm standing here today, and I'm asking myself, how am I going to do this? like Pastor said, but before we start, I want to pray. If we could just stand up real quick for a short prayer. I want to pray, Father God, that we want to thank you for this glorious day you've given us. Bless the children, the mothers, the fathers in our church, Lord. We ask healing, and we ask that you provide healing and peace to those that can't be here today, Lord. We thank you. I thank you for this wonderful opportunity to hear your voice, Lord. Holy Spirit, expand my capacity so that I can present that word that you have for one person. That it triggers that one person to better develop a relationship with you and with others. And Lord, I ask that you please calm these nerves of mine. Amen. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
So, as Pastor was saying, in the past few weeks, we've covered I do what I hear, and today, I do what I see. We have all heard phrases in our lives that related to sight. Love at first sight. Out of sight, out of mind. Is the glass half empty or half full? These quotes all say something. These quotes say that what we see has an impact on us. This is because our eyes are hardwired to our brains. And our brains process these images in a certain way. And depending on how you were raised, you'll translate what you see into a message that is unique to you. You'll create a thought, and that thought will lead to a plan of action, a reaction. And this happens almost instantly. Touching back on out of sight, out of mind, this one is interesting to me because if we don't see it, do we not think about it? Does that mean we won't act on it? The glass being half full or half empty speaks on your outlook. Are you a positive person or a negative person? Love at first sight. Oh, it does happen. Thomas, in John 20:27, Jesus is speaking to Thomas. His disciples, and Jesus tells him, put your finger here, see my hands, reach your hand and put it in my wounds. Sometimes, like Thomas, we need to see before we can believe. Most of us are this, And Jesus goes on and tells them, stop doubting and believe. But why is this? What we see influences our actions. What is it for? Is it protection? Is it relationship? Does God want me to be lonely? No. He wants us to see someone. Is it for health? What do you need? What is it that you're doing that's killing your body? Are you seeing them? Is it for our children? To ignore them? Or to help them see and guide them through life? We make choices. We react to what we see in every action, and every action will have a reaction. Herman's throwing the ball at me. Instantly trigger a reaction in all of us. I step back. You guys were what? You know what? That's a blue ball. That's a funny story with that ball. We were having a sleepover with a good friend, Jesse Mobbins, son Jesse, and we went to Walmart and he fell in love with that ball. And he told me, Dad, I got $1.25 at home. Would you buy it for me, please? Okay, you owe me $1.25. And even though Herman's throat was not to hurt me in this exercise, I process it the same way. You know, even if he was aiming for me or not aiming for me, I'm still gonna step back because I don't know his intention. I don't see his intention. I see that he's throwing something at me. It could be in jest, it could be plain, it could be to hurt. We do what we see. It's fruit of the Spirit. What about our actions, your actions? What impact do they have when somebody else sees you? Do you get mad and flip out quickly? Do your kids see you yell at that McDonald's teenager that put pickles on your burger? You go crazy to me, I don't want pickles. Yeah, but you probably can see. Or worse, you yell at your parents. You're not alone. We all need to be with our Genesis 37, the story of Joseph. I love it, he's got a great name. Where his brothers threw him into the cistern in the pit. They saw their father, Israel, loving more Joseph. And then this sparked jealousy. What they saw was their reaction. His father's reaction caused a reaction. And you know the story. It's got a great ending. You know, but the action triggered a reaction in the children. So it's important that what we see from others, the action that others are doing to us, causes a reaction that's favorable. Same thing with our children. I wanted us to watch a clip because the Lord changed everything. I wasn't able to get the clip up. But I have it on my tablet and we're going to give it a try. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. This clip it has no words. It's all what you see. And if we could dim the lights, maybe that'll help. Again, I apologize for not being prepared. Can we see this? I'm sorry that it's such a small screen. But if you were able to see it, and I apologize if you weren't, what do you see in your life? What do you see? Do you see fear in your life? Are you scared to move forward? Do you see failure in your life? Do you see blame? Is it your fault? Or is it theirs? Do you see that you're stuck? Do you see uncertainty? What's next? What's the next move? Where do I go? Are you lacking something? Is something in your life not there? Are you missing something? Are you procrastinating? You know what needs to be done. You just can't get to doing it. You see nothing but problems. You see excuses. You see judgment. Are you a victim? Did somebody do something wrong with you? Seen or are seeing things in our life such as these. It's worse when you see all of them together. You see that you are fearful because of your failure, because you're blaming someone else and you're stuck. Are you uncertain because you have lackness? Does that lead to hopelessness? Are you procrastinating? You know how to fix the problem. You got excuses. You judge. You're the victim. It's not my fault. How do we fix it? How do we move? It's difficult because when you're inundated with this, it's hard to redirect new transmission, to impact and redirect our lives towards God's given destiny and maturity in Christ. How do you do that? How do you redirect all these bad problems, excuses? Once you have the ability to take the focus off those things for a minute, for a second, focus on Jesus. your sons, at least a lifetime. If you focus on lack, not Jesus, you know what you're going to get. Lack. You have to pray. There's so much. The Bible is our handbook for life. All these things that we see are in here. And they're very popular verses. And I was up last night looking for verses, and it wasn't one verse that fixed this. It wasn't two. The pastor asked me, "What's your verse? What are you speaking on?" And I couldn't answer it. But there's so much in here. If you fear, if you have fear in your life, if you're scared of something, love. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, "For the spirit that God gave us does not make us timid. It gives us power, love, and self-discipline." That crushes fear. Are you failing at something? Business? School? Work? Church? Are you failing somewhere? Pray for a plan. Psalms 37:24. "The Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delights in him. Though he may stumble and will not fall, the Lord upholds him with his hand." You can follow that with Philippians 4:13. "You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you." Amen. 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 Are you blaming somebody for something? Somebody holding you responsible for something? Somebody blaming you? Galatians 6:15, "For each is responsible for their own conduct." 2 Samuel 12:13, David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." And Nathan said to David, "The Lord has put away your sin. You shall not die." God's not holding it against you. Are you stuck? Are you stuck? You can't move. You're frozen. Like a car in mud. How do you unstick yourself? You pray for choices. Psalm 46:10. "Be still and know that I am God." You're stuck. Be still for a second. Matthew 7:7 follows up saying, "Ask it and it will be given to you. Amen. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open." There's no reason to be stuck. You're stuck because you're choosing to be stuck. Uncertainty. What am I doing? Where am I going? Where is this headed? What do you pray for? You pray for clarity. Psalm 119:18. "Open my eyes that I may behold wonderful things from your law." 2 Corinthians 4:6. "For God who said, let light shall shine out of the darkness, is the one who has shown in our hearts to give light of knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ." God will give you clarity if you ask for it. But if you're stuck, you're going to get to uncertainty. Those two together are dangerous. Are you lacking something in your life? What are you missing? Dig deep. We're all missing something. Financial, love, partner, something. And that's what the problem is. John 10:10 says, "The thief comes to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." Was beautiful. Job 36:28, "When which the clouds pour down, they drip upon man abundantly." Bro, think about this. He wants to rain on you. Wolf words, R-A-I-N-G-M-R-A-I-N. He wants to rain over you. He wants to bless you. Luke 6:38, "Give If you're lacking, you gotta give. If you're lacking, you gotta give so that it too may be given to you. They will pour into your lap a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. For by the standard of measure, it will be measured to you in return. What you give, you get. Are you broke? Are you tired? Is there a connection? Do you feel like nobody's loving you? Do you lack your love? Who are you loving, huh? Hopelessness. That's easy. If you have no hope, you pray for hope. John 14:27 says, "Peace I live with you, may peace I give you. I do not give it to you as the world gives it. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Hope. Isaiah 40:31. "But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." Oh. Are you lazy? Are you procrastinating? Do you know what needs to be done yet? You just cannot seem to get off that couch to do it. You cannot get off the phone. Cannot get off Facebook. You know what needs to be done, but you're procrastinating. You pray for action. Proverbs 15:19. "The way of the lazy is a hedge of thorns, but the path of the upright is a highway." James 2:18 also says on procrastination and action. But someone will say, "You have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works." 1 Peter 1:13 says, "Therefore, prepare your mind, being sober-minded. Set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you in the revelation of Jesus Christ." Action. Problems. Who here has a problem? There's four honest people. Who here has problems?
Everybody.
Can you pray for me? Pray for solution. Specific solution. Psalm 50:15. "And call on me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you, and you will honor me." Call on me. Call on me. "I will sing of your strength in the morning. I will sing of your love, for you are my fortress, my refuge in the times of trouble." We've all heard all this. Excuse me. Why didn't you do it? Excuses. We all have excuses. Why didn't you come to read your own life? What's your excuse? And don't say it's a reason. "In all your ways, submit to him. He will make your paths right." Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." Yo, to give us a future, it's already planned. Judgment. We pray for acceptance. John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." Judgment. We're here. God didn't judge us. So once we stop seeing fear, failure, blame, once you get unstuck, once you get past the uncertainty, once you get over the lack, the hopelessness, procrastination, the problems, excuses, and the judgment, and stop being a victim, Once you stop there, let me, I would like to testify part of my story. The testimony is important because it says, it shows, you can see what the Lord has done in our lives. Some of you have heard this before, some of you may not. My wife and I, we've been together 16 years. We've been married for 3. Listen to that. Together 16 years, together and married for 3. There's 13 years that are in sin. And I tell you that the past 3 years, we've had more growth. We have seen more blessing poured upon us when we stopped that sin than the first 13 years. 13 years we suffered. We had all these things. We had uncertainty. We were stuck. We were blaming each other. We were uncertain. We were procrastinating. I know I was. Making excuses. We were judging each other. We were victims of our own thoughts, of our own sin. Why? Because our focus was not what it needed to be. For 13 years, we wanted to do it our way. We wanted to do it our way for 13 years. It's not until we blew up, and we were about to break up, that we became obedient.
Yes.
You have to become obedient.
Yeah.
You just can't be. You have to become it. Yeah. It's not. It's a lifestyle. You have to become obedient. You have to become sensitive to what the Lord is telling you. You have to. You have to listen. You have to listen. Now, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. You know, what is it when you don't listen to your mother, your father? If you're not obedient, you are setting yourself up for a failure. You're basically telling yourself, I can do this, whatever. Okay. But what happens when you get cocotazo? Is a love term. It's a slight punishment in the back of the head with a knuckle by most Latino families. But when you're disobedient and you don't have a lifestyle of obedience and you don't have a lifestyle of loving and obeying the Lord, and you're the man, you're the girl, and you better be ready for your popo tafos.
Right.
You know? They are. For real, you better be ready for them. It's your life. You want to live it. You want to live it in fear. You want to live in failure. You have to start seeing a different picture of yourself. I don't have one of those. Sorry. You have to start acting instead of fear. You got to start loving. Instead of seeing failure, with a plan, with responsibility. Make good choices with clarity. Your children are watching. If you don't have children, your brother, your sister, your friends are watching you. And guess what? You're their teacher. You're teaching them something. Are you cool? You have to party. Somebody's watching them. Be clear. This will cancel out lack and bring abundance. It'll cancel hopelessness and bring hope. Your new actions, your new act will bring solutions, will bring results. You'll have acceptance. You need to stop being a victim. Oh, poor little me. Become a hero to somebody. It's me. No, it's not you. You You are not here to be a victim. You are not placed on this earth to suffer. You're here to love and worship the Lord and serve others. You are here to become a hero for somebody else. To lift that one person that can't give up. To feed that one person that can't be fed by somebody else. You have a purpose in this planet. You have to act. Pastor said, give them something to take home. Act. A-C-T. You have to analyze what you see. See, you have to check yourself. How are you interpreting what you see? How are you going to react? You have to trust in God, for He will give you your next move. You need to act correctly in what you see. I do what I see. What do you see? How are you going to take that and make it better? How are you going to get out of where you're at? It's a choice of obedience. It's a choice of seeing a different story of your life. If you have fear, if you have failure, if you're blaming somebody, if you're stuck, if you're uncertain, if you're lagging, if you're hopeless, if you're procrastinating, if you have problems, if you have excuses, if you have judgment, I dare you stand up. If you have fear, if you're failing at something, and you're blaming somebody, if you're stuck, if you're uncertain, if you're lacking, if you're hopeless, if you're procrastinating, and you have problems, and you have excuses, stop being a victim. Normally we do an altar call and we have somebody else pray for you. When you start praying for yourself, the leaders here also have to pray. Then you also have to pray for yourselves. It's time for you to start saying, Lord, read those verses again. Which one do you need? Where do you start? Open my eyes that I may behold wonderful things. Stop praying for your lives. Make a change. You know, not too long ago, a reality hit my life, and it was a thought that if I'm gonna live to be 80 years old, I'm halfway through my life. How do I choose to live those last 40 years? How are you gonna live the rest of your life? How are your children? Think of your children. Think of your children. Think of your mom. Think of your dad. How are you going to live when you die? And I don't want to be grim. What's the last thing you're going to say? What are the last words you're going to say? I wish I worked more. No, you're going to say, I wish I spent more time with my wife. You're going to say, I wish I had a better relationship with your daughter. This is where it starts. I would love for today to be that first day that you act differently, that you analyze, that you check yourself, and then you trust. Act a different way. All these things are created by the world. Fear, failure, lack, procrastination. Close your eyes. And I want for you to be still.